Hi, this is Judy Saalinger from Lasting Recovery, San Diego's premier outpatient alcohol and drug treatment center. And today we're talking about
somehow have to be able to stay sane, and we have systems for doing this as well. I have to have a framework to understand who I am, how I fit into the world, and I'm going to use things like meaning. I'm going to prioritize what sorts of things are going to get me the end goals, and I'm going to see those as being more salient than other things. I'm going to see my relationships as being particularly important to me. And I overall, I have a framework to organize my world in a way that makes sense to me, and so that the kinds of things that I'm doing feel good and that I want to continue doing them. Sometimes there's some conflict between kind of my worldview and what's happening around me, and I have to have some sort of a system for being able to manage that. So if there's things going on that are in conflict with what it is that I need to do, I have to be able to deal with that, because otherwise if things were in conflict with my meaning, my sense of who I am, and what's important and what I need to do next, I might end up just freezing up and not being able to function. And so we have ways of adapting to this to prevent that from happening, because organisms that freeze up and stop functioning are not able to survive long enough to reproduce, and they're not able to survive long enough to rear their offspring. And as a result of that, it's not very good for their species. And so we have workarounds, and because we're different from the lizards, we can do this. We can do this, and to understand how this works, I'm going to take us to a guy named Sigmund Freud. Now, Sigmund Freud came up with a lot of interesting things, and so not everybody really always agrees with some of what he came up with. Like, he came up with certain kinds of envy that some people find offensive, and perhaps rightfully so. But he did come up with something called defense mechanisms. He listed 10 of them, to be specific. And you'll be hard pressed to find anybody in the field of psychology that disagrees with this concept of defense mechanisms. His idea was that we have the ability to kind of distort reality to prevent our psyche from information that would be too challenging to allow us to continue functioning. And a few of these, and addiction uses this circuitry, the ability to distort reality so that I can continue to function. It brings this on as part of the circuitry that kind of keeps this thing in place. If I find myself going to Cinnabon instead of meeting with my friend repeatedly, then I'm sitting there with this discrepancy between what I thought was important and what my actions are. I'm going to have to find some resolution for that, or else I'm going to kind of go nuts, especially if I regularly find myself doing this. So these defense mechanisms that are there naturally in all human beings that allow us to distort reality to kind of adjust things enough to be able to kind of continue functioning get brought online. Three that are particularly useful in addiction are going to be rationalization. If you had my problems, you'd be doing this too. A projection. Me, you need to look at you. You're the one with a problem. Rationalization, projection, denial. I don't have a problem. I have a job. People with jobs obviously can't be addicts, alcoholics, etc., because, those people are bums. And this denial system that would come in place. And these are helpful that allow me to kind of reorient. Therefore, I can say that and then I'm going to maybe come up with some sort of a distortion as to why, in this particular case, Cinnabon was okay because of whatever rationalization I'm going to create around that. And you're supposed to understand Mr. or Mrs. Person who had an appointment with me at the store down the way. And I go on about my business, and that this system keeps me from going nuts and it keeps me functioning. And it's this very human function. That is what I call the crowning jewel in addiction. It's the ability to distort reality, to continue my substance use, to keep my world intact. And the further into this addictive process an individual goes, the more things that come into conflict with kind of their worldview and reality, and that there's this ongoing disruption and distortion of reality, if you will, in order to kind of make room for it so that they can continue functioning. And so these systems that are very, very adaptive for human beings are the exact same systems that become brought online in this phenomenon that we call addiction. And as time goes on, more and more of these adaptations, this denial, this rationalization takes place until the individual starts changing who they are, changing what's important in the world, changes some of the kind of fundamental components of their whole entire worldview, where the importance of substance use gets brought online as being as a primary need for their survival, which is how they really experience it. And therefore, it becomes adaptive regardless of the situation. Reality is distorted sufficiently enough to make room for that. Unfortunately, at times, they're faced with what in a 12-step community they call moments of clarity, where there's some distress that's created. But defense mechanisms are strong. If I experience this moment of clarity without some sort of crisis or intervention to change something, given enough time, defense mechanisms will eventually come back online and protect me from that reality. There will be a good and an adequate distortion to kind of get me rolling again and get me back off to the races. And maybe this is another thing that you might have been observing with your loved ones that might make sense. So it's like, why can't you see what I see? Well, the truth is they can't. They could if they had a choice about stopping for Cinnabon, for example. But since they already stopped for Cinnabon and they keep doing it, they got to come up with some sort of explanation for why it's happening. And this isn't a choice. This is this neuroadaptation in their brain, in their physiology, which is what neuroadaptation is, has changed them. They no longer get the choice of whether or not they're going to stop for Cinnabon. They can't even prioritize in that moment that it's necessarily any different than any of the other choices, because they've been impaired in that way. They perceive it as being way more pleasurable than it is. And the really interesting thing about it is because they continually get this reward, they probably don't even find stopping for Cinnabon that pleasurable anymore. That they just do it, and it doesn't give them anywhere near the amount of pleasure that it once did. But the memory of that pleasure will keep them going back to it as if it's going to this time over and over and over again. And the more that they do this, the more that their ability to adequately prioritize what's more important becomes more and more impaired as time goes on. The ability to distort reality is something that's learned in a profound way, arguably a permanent way. The ability to distort reality, we're all capable. You'll notice that every single thing that we're talking about in addiction is something that everybody in the room has. We all have this physiology, we all have these structures. They're very adaptive and they're necessary for our survival. And without them, our ancestors never would have got us here. Every single one of them. However, in addiction, things change. And there's this adaptation to this. Now the individual thinks they know who they are. But that entire framework has been developed around distortions in reality to facilitate this phenomenon. They actually like it. They see it as a preferred way of being. They've changed from who they were. If you were to go back in time and when they were younger, is this what you wanted for yourself? Nobody would say that. There isn't an addict on the planet that, if they were able to really be accurate about what it is that they're experiencing in the present day in active addiction, when they were a kid, would have said, yeah, that's what I'm shooting for right there. And yet, it's integrated in their very being and seen as preferable. And it makes sense. It actually makes sense to the individual. That's what we're dealing with here. And just stop it too, like I do, isn't going to work. That's why you can't impose consequences on an addict and expect them to respond to those consequences the way you would. Their brain isn't seeing it that way. Eventually, their brain isn't going to be able to see your consequence, your imposed consequence, is any more salient than the reward. And in fact, really, the reward is so strong in this individual, it's probably going to win out in that fight. And it doesn't have to win out like best 2 out of 3, best 3 out of 5. One time gets the ball rolling again. Because once the individual has gotten reward, the impulse to continue seeking that reward is going to be strong and ongoing.